This is the Unstarving Musicians Podcast. The podcast features conversations with musicians and music industry professionals, all intended to help musicians be better at marketing, business, the creative process, and all the other things that empower us to do more of what we love, make music. Hey, it's your host, Robonzo. Thank you for tuning in. If you are an indie music artist or fan, you're in the right place. Whoever you are, I appreciate you. As a gigging musician and fan of live music, I'm committed to sharing my personal experience, including everything I'm learning from other artists and music industry professionals on this podcast. If you'd like to be privy to all of my learnings, pop over to unstarvingmusician.com and join the community. You'll get an email from me, usually weekly, with tips, insights, and secrets intended to make your music journey a little better and brighter. I'll never send you anything spammy, and you can unsubscribe at any time. Right. Today's featured guest is Mike Osborn. Mike is a returning guest. He was featured way back in episode 34 when I did a special format listener Q&A episode. This is a standard format interview episode, and I ask Mike about his use of Reverb Nation. We talk about pickup bands and the blues scene, something we're both fascinated in. We also talk about problematic drummers because this is something he has emailed me about. We discuss merchandising, diversification for survival in music, marketing, his forthcoming album, and the stories behind it. You can find Mike on Facebook. That's the best place anyway, and it's Mike Osborn Band on Facebook. And I have a featured track for your enjoyment at the end of the episode. The track is by Mike Osborn, of course, and it's called Wish I Had a Time Machine. Okay, here's me and Mike. Mike, welcome back to the podcast.
Hey, glad to be back.
Hey, man, I was just listening to Lovin' Time. I think that's the title of the track. You do have a track by that time. I feel like I wrote it down wrong. Is that when you're... Yeah. I was checking out a gig announcement you had on Facebook, and it led me to Reverb Nation, which led me to this song. Can you tell me a little bit about the track?
Well, that was a song on my last album that I put out called In the Doghouse. It's a great song. It's a nice, upbeat, danceable one. It's actually the only track on that album that we did an official video for also, which that's up. I've got it hosted on YouTube, I think, and it's all over the place, but... It's one that my songwriting mentor and producer, Al Murakatani, wrote that. And he really pitched it to me about halfway through the album, saying that he thought that this one, like stylistically, was just right up my alley. And I can't remember for sure. I think he even said he wrote it with me in mind, but could have been part of his pitch, though. But see, I'm that blend of blues, rock, and country, and that really kind of fits that.
Yeah, it does. I mean, stylistically, it sounds like you, and from the stuff that I've heard, and that's because probably most of what I've heard has been from In the Doghouse, so I'm a little embarrassed. I didn't recognize it as being from there. It's been a while since I listened to the whole album, but I was like, oh, this is pretty nice. At first, I was like, wow, is that like a live performance? But it was like a kind of a promo track for the gig that's coming up, I think.
Oh, could have been, yeah.
On that note of Reverb Nation, like I was looking at some of your gig announcements and I was kind of curious if they were some automated announcements by Reverb Nation. And I just wanted to ask you, are you using them much? And if so, does it work well? Has it done anything good for you?
I do use Reverb Nation a lot. And I've got the thing where I think I'm paying about $5 a month for some of the extra features. But it used to be I had like three different calendars I had to update every time there was a gig. Or God forbid, one canceled. And it just made it, I used that as a watershed. So I put a widget on all my sites of my Reverb Nation calendar. So that was the first thing that attracted me to it. I've got an RPK on there, you know, so I didn't have to pay, I forget the name of the other one I was using, didn't have to pay them. It's just something that was quick, easy. And then, yeah, all that stuff's automated. I don't have to make an event like on Facebook. It just automatically blasts it out. I linked it to all my social media sites.
Cool.
It makes life easy. However, I've gone to multiple calendars again. So because the website, there were some reasons why I needed to go to Google calendars. And, of course, I had to divide up. I'm getting so much work on the solo and acoustic stuff. That I had to make a whole different calendar for that. I didn't want to start confusing people. People were showing up. expecting me to wail on the lead guitar. Instead, I was sitting there by myself with an acoustic strumming and singing. So I had to do that.
So you're maintaining a completely separate calendar largely so that you can delineate the two different sort of configurations, acoustic versus not?
Yeah, they're sort of my main brand and brand X, you know, the way I see it from a business standpoint. That's how I look at it. However, the unplugged thing, which was supposed to be the sideline, is keeping me busier.
Sure.
It's easier. There's more gigs. You know, there's more places that can have music when it's not as loud.
Yeah, particularly in the Bay Area, it seems like that's sort of been the case for a while. I'm curious, why do you use Google Calendar on the Mike Osborn Band site? Or what, I should ask it a different way, what appeals to you about it? What do you like about it?
My web designer, Sandy, at Graphically, it's the things on the bottom of my web. She's amazing. Anybody needs help, go to my website, go to the bottom and click on her. She will hook you up. She's fantastic and very reasonable. She's the one that said, you know, let's go to Google Calendars. And at this moment, honestly, I can't remember what the reasons were, but she sold me on it. And it just, there was some reasons why it would work better on the website. And I think people can access it publicly also. Where Reverb Nation, really, I mean, it's a small chunk of people that'll go there compared to Google.
Yeah, I mean, I guess with Reverb that they do some social network populating or, you know, posts, that's in and of itself is pretty cool. And yeah, okay, I can see the Google Calendar advantages. You know, when I was looking at it, like just from a user, I guess, sort of user experience on the website, I've used them before on different websites and I was like, man, it's okay. I'm kind of like trying to figure out what was exciting about it. But now that you mentioned that, well, I was thinking too, like this is your calendar. I mean, like this is what you use to know where you're supposed to be. And it's sort of, you don't have to go post it somewhere else. So that's very cool for you. You're saving time. And then, yeah, I mean, people can subscribe to your, I think that's what they call it, to your calendar. So I could see that would be handy too. So, okay, that makes sense.
Yeah.
And then the other one's got the like, oh, unplugged. Okay, so that pops you over to Reverb Nation. Then it's got the sort of nice whatever layout of announcements. Okay. Yeah, sorry to drag you down that rabbit hole. I was just curious.
No, yeah, I made a separate Reverb Nation account for Mike Osborn Unplugged, and that's the only place I have it. It's linked as a page on my .com site, and that's the only place I keep the calendar.
Yep, yep. You said RPK, was that, and what is that?
You know, that's that digital press kit.
Okay.
Yeah, it's what we used to have to send in the mail, a physical thing. It's basically a, you know, it's done.
I haven't heard it called an RPK. What's the R for?
I don't remember what the R is for. I had always heard
it's
it
the
as
Reverb Nation press kit, probably.
Yeah, probably. It's an EPK, electronic press kit. That's what I would.
I've heard lately one page, or the artist's one page, and I'm like, oh, that's new, but it's an EPK. I like it better than EPK, but.
The one sheet isn't exactly the same thing as a press kit. That's like a quick and dirty, whereas the press kit will, I mean, they're pretty similar, but they were started out for different reasons. But anyway, that's moot.
Well, no, and to clarify too, for anybody who, I mean, I'm sure there are people listening who know a lot more about this than I do, but now a traditional press kit would have collateral included in it so that if somebody's going to actually co-market with you, which it seems like in a lot of cases nobody ever does, but if they're going to co-market with you, you'd have all the assets that they need there, where the one sheet or the one page is going to just be a fancy looking blurb with maybe some links to some audio and stuff. So.
Right.
Okay. Whew, man, sorry.
So, hey, it's all good.
Let me start with this because I'm afraid if I reverse it, I'm not going to get some of this and I'm being selfish, but you've been very communicative with me over email as a member of the Robonzo Nation. I just made that up. It's not a real thing. It's actually the Unstarving the Unstarving Musicians. I know, right? The Unstarving Musicians community. But so let me read something here that you wrote to me and then we can start some questions there. So I wrote an email, something I learned from blues people, but you said, the blues guys I know who tour with pickup bands have varying degrees of success from town to town on talent, and usually after a couple of years end up developing regular bands in those areas that they use every time they go through. Another plus to doing this sort of like pickup band approach, you didn't say all that part, but another plus you went on to say is using local musicians, is it helps withdraw. These guys have friends, makes sense to me. And then you said fans and family in the local market and pluses all the way around as long as they don't suck on stage. Assuming that the guys that are having more success than than others are good at networking? Because I have to assume that's probably their number one asset, that they really developed a network and have good relationships. But are there other things that you can think of that these guys that are successful at doing in the blues genre, where it's considerably more possible than if you're focused on, say, rock, for instance, to get pickup bands? What do you think those guys are doing a little differently that makes them more successful than the ones who struggle with doing this?
First, they're able to prime the pump. They either have the deep pockets or the long-sightedness or both to go for at a loss or a break even the first couple times or so. And they just keep building it up. They're oftentimes people that are very dynamic at networking and socializing. And we use the word schmoozing, but they're the kind of people that will walk into a Starbucks and end up walking out with five new friends that they met and chatted up with. And some people are just fantastic at that. Some people aren't. And there's people like me. It's like, spin the dial. Today, I'm the Mr. Life of the Party guy. Tomorrow, I want to hide in a shadow. That's just me. I have no explanation for that.
You're an introverted extrovert.
Yeah, it just depends on the day and my mental state, but maybe how overwhelmed I am. I don't know. They're good at that. But then the thing that'll carry you really far, but it really breaks down to the personal relationships. But outside of that, it's the guys who just really can deliver the goods at that point. All things considered, when people walk away from musician A's show feeling awesome, as opposed to musician C's show where they were like, cool show, they're more likely to get people to come back. When you combine those together, you've got, this guy's the guy I met at Starbucks. He's such a cool guy. We had a great time. We both love cats. You know what I mean? And the guy is effing amazing. I can't believe how great a musician or the great entertainment that they provided. When you put those two together, I mean, you're stacking the cards in your favor of building a strong, loyal following.
Yeah, yeah. To back up a little bit for anybody who's wondering why I read that, we're talking about that. A while back, it dawned on me after interviewing a handful of blues artists and just sort of reflecting on conversations I'd had with other ones in the past, mostly in San Jose, California, just because that's where I met most of them, that these guys have the ability to tour with relative ease, comparatively speaking, by using what are called pickup bands. So they can do something like go outside the country at where they can find musicians who speak the universal language or know the universal conventions of the blues. And it is a little unique to blues for sure. And I imagine that jazz is similar as well. When you have the guy, you have these communities around the world.
You got your jazz book.
Yeah. And these people who are part of that community who can do it. But then I'm sure when I was looking back at your email, I was like, yeah, while that is wonderful, it's probably not always super easy like it may have sounded when these guys were telling me about it. And these are guys who probably have worked on it for a while. And then I think it might have been in the same email, and I love how you ended the comment, you talked about, sometimes the guys aren't always, these are my words, not yours, but more or less, sometimes the guys that you find in pickup bands the first, second time around aren't necessarily the best you've ever played with, but they'll get the job done. And if you have like a really outstanding front man, you said, that can carry you a long way. And then you quickly went off on that the biggest X factor was drummers. And I'm always a little amazed and surprised by one of the things you said about this, and that they're always hard to find. Because as a drummer, when I go around, I'm always amazed at how many great ones I get to see. But I don't know what the disconnect is, because there are a lot of them out there for sure. But then you also said, hey, maybe it'd be a good subject. Why are drummers always late to the gig, and why are there so few good ones, et cetera, et cetera. But I do love how you finished it and said, no offense.
Well, I knew you weren't one of them, but you're probably aware. I mean, you're probably aware of that. I don't know what it is. I mean, I've had, of course, since I can sing and play and do them both at the same time, I can get by and generally do with just a bass player and drummer backing me up. So I've had very little problems with bass players, but drummers have been almost a constant thorn in my side for 11 years now.
That's funny. Yeah.
In one degree or another.
It depends on who I talk to. I hear some people say, man, good bass players are so hard to find. But I hear a lot of people say good drummers, just the right drummer, really. It's not necessarily that there's not talent, but just the right drummer, I think, is probably what they really mean to say most of the time. Because there's a lot of things I know you'll appreciate this, is that it's not always the best musician that is the best for the gig. It's the right musician.
Yeah, I get you. I guess it depends on how you define those terms. So like, if you're talking about Mr. Technical Excellence or the greatest, the guy that can play the greatest solo, that doesn't necessarily make him the best musician in my mind.
Exactly. That's kind of what I was talking about. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like if a drummer, first and foremost, can't keep a beat, I don't care how good he can play a solo.
Exactly. Yeah.
So that makes him not a good drummer in my mind. It doesn't know how to play the right beat, doesn't listen, doesn't pay attention. If he doesn't speed up, that's a good thing. You know, it's tough there. I'll tell you one thing that has helped me a lot getting good drummers, and that is always having a really good bass player.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. They always know who the really good drummers are, too.
They want to work the good drummers. I've lassoed some in that hadn't worked with me before, and they were like, yeah, call me anytime, man. You always get good bass players. I'm only too happy to work with you. It makes their life wonderful when they're playing with a really good bass player and they lock up.
Oh, yeah. I think that bass players are probably a little more accommodating. A drummer will fall all over themselves to be with a good bass player, though.
Yeah.
That's true. You made me think when you were making the comment about, I'll just mention this and just maybe so we can close on the point, but drive it home. You know, I was talking to a friend who's a very accomplished artist and has had a great career, still doing it. And he was, I'll just say, I won't mention names, but he was showing me a video of a live performance at a festival that he was doing. And he was talking about a couple of the guys on stage. And one of them, I asked where he found him. It was a keyboard player. And so this guy's like, he's the first call guy. I'll narrow it down a little bit, in all of Panama. But because of that, and I guess because there's just, I guess, not a lot of competition for him, because he's that good, and maybe there's just not that many. He's really good. I'm not going to lie, though. I was watching the video and listening to him, and he was amazing. But the comments I heard were like, yeah, he doesn't show up to rehearsal. And if he shows up, he comes without his charts. And the day of that gig, he drove up. This is a festival. He drove up 10 minutes before, in the parking lot, 10 minutes before showtime. And I'm like, wow.
Not appreciated.
No, yeah, makes me crazy.
That is not cool.
I'm almost like, I don't care how good they are, but
if they're not there, they're no good.
If your talent pool's limited, maybe you just don't have a keyboard player. I don't know.
Right. Either that, or you decide you're going to just live with it. And it's unfortunate. I mean, that stuff brings me right up to the edge of, God, I think I'm just not going to do band stuff anymore.
Don't do it, man. Stay with it. You'll always have the good people. Just think, you know, be positive. So another thing you brought up from one of our email exchanges that I wanted to ask you about, and I don't know if what exactly the context of the email was, or like what I was getting into when I sent it out, but we somehow got on the thread of merchandise, and you had commented at the time, which is a while back, that you'd gotten a little lazy, but it was about time for you to come out with some new merch. I was going to ask you, have you come out with anything new yet?
Well, I've got new albums that are going to be coming out very soon. Possibly as early as the end of this month, I'll have finished product in hand.
Sweet.
For a new band album. And I will definitely get new t-shirts and come up with some other things to go along with that. So not yet, but I've been working on it, I should say.
And I brought it up because you made the comment, which I think is good for others to hear, is that you've really appreciated the artists that are come up with creative merch. And you talked about, maybe you can share this particular case, but you talked about a band called Math Class.
Yeah. I think they're brilliant. Now, they're just a local cover band. They're not a recording artist or touring band, but the last name of the lead singer and his wife, who sings also, is McMath. And they're doing primarily 80s genre stuff. I think they're doing some 90s too. And so if you remember, the whole Revenge of the Nerds franchise was really big in the 80s. So they went with that, and they're calling the band Math Class. And they've got these, we used to call them back then Nerd Nays, because the Varnays were the hip thing. And these were like the nerd glasses, the nerd reading glasses with the big, and then they'd always have like the white tape holding it together around the nose. And so they actually had some made up. They've got them produce these, and they sell on their merch table t-shirts and the Nerd Nays. I don't know what they're calling, you know, the nerd glasses, where they're they probably should get into pocket protectors next, you know. And I'm watching their fans show up at their gigs with their glasses, their math class glasses and shirts on. And I was like, wow, this is really smart. This is smart of these guys. Nice work. They figured out a way to come up with a unique merch item that ties in to their whole brand and the genre that they're, I think it was pretty brilliant. They wrapped it all up in a neat little package and people are digging it.
Yeah, I thought that was a cool story. I appreciate you, or example, I appreciate you sharing it. And I've had some other artists talk about some of the things that they've done. And one guy very recently said, I think it was Dean Johannesson, who was one of my most recent interviews, but he tries to introduce new stuff frequently because he performs so much. And he kind of feels like, at least in some parts of his touring circuit or performance circuit, he's got some of the same folks coming out to see him. And so he's always wanting to like surprise them with something new. So that's been a big deal for him. But I thought this was pretty cool. And I'm sure there are probably some other great examples where someone went with the clever thematic thing, which I liked.
I mean, the sky's the limit. Your creativity, once you have a clearly defined brand, it's all up to your creativity. But you do have to keep coming up with new things, because what are you going to do when they've already bought your album and they've already bought your t-shirt?
Yeah.
You've got to keep coming up with new things.
Yeah, totally. So, you're still teaching, right? Teaching guitar?
Yes. I teach 2 evenings a week right now.
Okay. Do you or have you ever done any of that online, or just do you do one-on-one?
I have not done any online. I don't see any problem with doing a Skype lesson, and I would. I haven't pursued that or marketed that. What I'm primarily doing, it was something I fell into that's a complete turnkey situation. There's this small music school. It's all the way on the other side of town, but they saw me playing an outdoor acoustic gig and were like, hey, we need a guitar teacher. And basically, I mean, it's their place. They do the advertising. I have a room there and I put my stuff in the room and I show up and teach the students and collect a check every month. So it's really easy. I don't have to work to bring students in. I just teach them and keep them as long as I can.
Yeah, that's nice. That's a nice situation.
I do get private students. I've done some Craigslist ads and gotten private students on the side. The thing is, I mean, I'm a professional musician. I'm not a professional music teacher. That is a sideline. I don't want to market that too hard. I don't have the time.
I got it. Yeah.
So if I get more than, I don't know, a dozen, or the most I've ever had is 18 in a month, and that was pushing it. 12, 15, maybe 16 students a month, maybe.
That's a lot.
And it's pushing it. Yeah. And the busier my performing schedule gets, the harder it is to keep doing it. So there may come a time where I have to let that go. I don't know. Because I make so much more money when I step on stage per hour than I do to teach. And I get paid a very fair rate to teach. I'm not knocking that part at all, but it's just that I get paid really good to step on stage and perform.
Oh, good. That's cool.
Yeah.
And so the one you were describing, is that a classroom or multiple students, or is it one-on-one?
Typically one-on-one. I've done multiples, but for the longest time now, it's just been one-on-one. So I have a little teaching studio over there with a guitar and a computer, and they come at their time. I teach them, we move on. It's cool, though. It is cool helping to be part of shaping the next generation of musicians. That is rewarding. And some of these guys are wonderful. And I've gotten them on stage. Some of my more advanced students, I've gotten them out to my gigs and put them up on stage with me.
Nice.
That's cool.
It's funny. I asked, you know, I had another member of the Robonzo Nation. Again, I just made that up today. But I sent out an email about teaching, which is probably why you and I were talking about it. We weren't talking about it. I just want to ask you. But he mentioned to me that he is teaching. And I was curious as to whether he was doing it online. And so anyway, we've been kind of back and forth with some questions. But I've kind of run across the gamut. I've run across two guys here locally that are like, yeah, I used to have whatever number, 12 or more students, whatever they said, but now I don't, thanks to YouTube. And I was like, well, okay. I mean, I can understand how it impacted, but I think for some people, maybe not both of these guys, but I think for some people that's sort of like, well, it's done and they don't even try anymore, when certainly it still works. And then Dean Johannesson, who I just mentioned, he has a music class that he does. He's a guitarist and probably multi-instrumentalist, but he has a music class for youth, young people, children. He was kind of different. I mean, most people that I've spoken with, I think, are a little more like you in that they're doing the one-on-one. And then I'm pretty sure I know, at least I'm just thinking of guests, I do know people who teach online and do it really big, but I'm trying to think. But I think I have some of my guests who have too. So I was just curious, but it seems to be all over the map.
There's a bunch of ways to go with it. And it's true that the technology is hurting us in a lot of categories, but that doesn't mean that you can't sort of switch it up somehow and keep going on that if you want. And I have found that I didn't start really balancing my financial boat until I diversified. And when I started diversifying as much as possible, I've got two different acoustic shows that I do, two different band shows. One's geared mostly towards originals, the other was more towards covers, which I do less and less of that now because I don't need to anymore. I'll blend them together. Like, I got a private party gig this weekend. Pays really good. You're going to have to primarily do covers. And then the teaching, plus whatever I'm making off of my online sales and merchandise. So that's kind of, one could say that's five or six different streams of revenue.
Yeah, every artist I've talked to who is, I guess it's safe for me to say, like the full-timers, they're all feeding their income through different means musically, and sometimes it's not necessarily musically, but it's creatively. So things like writing books or creating mentoring communities, all kinds of stuff. And I think you saw, probably saw one email I did with, then you've got the guys like, one email that I sent out that you and I had some back and forth on mentions Joe George among others, but Joe George is one of these guys who happens to have a great job in the music industry that allows him to use his music talent with his regular paycheck gig, and then he can still create music, and they're very nurturing of that. So, but yeah, you're not alone, and
that's very cool.
Yeah, I know. So you have a lot of new marketing stuff to tell us about, and that was one of the reasons that I wanted to get on the conversation with you. Tell me what's going on and what you're hoping to do.
I wish it was farther along so I could give you some results reports. We're still in the development stage, but there's something I became involved with a few years back called, it's online, a guy named John Oszajca, and it's called Music Marketing Manifesto. And he has this program that, it's a modest fee. I think it's under 200. I'd have to look, but he comes up with upgraded versions. And basically, he was a professional musician, like signed to a major label and all that. And then he got into online marketing real heavily. And then he figured out how to do that for music, because it's a unique skill set to do that for music. The regular online marketing stuff alone won't work for a musician. It has to be tweaked for the musical, for our industry. So I bought that program and I learned a bunch. The thing is there's man hours involved. Like, so basically you can do it yourself, and he teaches you how to do it, and he offered support. But you didn't just buy this tape and you were on your own. He offered support in real time. I mean, I was impressed with that. And he knew what he was doing. He was constantly updating it as technology changed and trends changed. But in the end, at the time, I just didn't have the time. I didn't have the man hours to put into making this happen. But, I learned a lot. And then anyway, years went by and I stayed in touch and I stayed involved, but I never got to put the thing into practice really. And they just opened up a branch. I think they're calling it DTFI, where they're actually running the campaign for you. So I was one of the first to sign up. I said, let's do this. I had just gotten funding for another CD, and the part of it that I had earmarked that I would normally spend on a publicist, I said, I'm going to put it into this. And this is designed to build a loyal fan base online, which will result in online merchandise sales in a kind of a continuing manner. I mean, it would take me too long to even give a quick overview, but it's pretty impressive. So we're in the process of setting this up, and they've had, they asked me a million questions, my whole life story. They want to put a branding thing together. It's wonderful. And I'll keep you posted as it goes, because if this is successful at all, it's a game changer for us indies. It's like, hey, just either if you've got the time, go buy the program, Music Marketing Manifesto, and do it yourself. But if you've got the money and you feel like you need more help, or you're like me, you just can't squeeze the hours in edgewise, man, I'll tell you if this is worth it or not. And people can get onto that. And man, you're not going to get the airplay and the magazine reviews that a publicist will give you, but they'll put the dollars to your bottom line.
Yeah. Oh, cool. I found him very quickly. Sorry for sidetracking you, but it's Oszajca for those who are interested, and I'll put it in the show notes.
Oh, yeah.
It's at musicmarketingmanifesto.com. So, well, that's cool that he's doing that. And interestingly, most of the artists that I've spoken with are DIY. So, and I've spoken with other educators or people who have programs like this. I don't think maybe that's a better way to say it. Carlos Castillo comes to mind because he has a social media methodology for musicians that he adapted from business school that has worked really well. And he does a lot of other cool stuff for his students as well. But it kind of sounds, in a way, I think that John's offering different types of stuff, but I get the general concept. But that's nice that he's coming out with a full service platform. And I will look very forward to hearing from you as to how it's going, because I know other people will want to know about it.
Yeah, I will look forward to letting you know, because I'll spread the word if these guys are really going to do things. It's been a tough road in that department, and really that's my best hope at some sort of a retirement plan. You've got to get more money coming in regardless of whether you're working. I mean, I'm working so hard. Like I just said, I didn't have time. It's not because I'm sitting on my butt.
Yeah, I mean, anyone who's doing anything creatively, or whether they're creating online content for people or doing podcasting or they're a musician, there's a point at which you're doing everything yourself. And then there's a point at which, well, if I want to grow it, I've got to figure out how to inject the funds into it and get the right team together. So it sounds like what you're doing. I mean, without having to detail all the things that are available, what was it that caught your eye? Like, what are the one or two things that you saw that it could do for you that you're really looking forward to or hoping will really work out?
That it could do for me? Well, what they're going to do is they're going to build relationships online. Are they going to help me to do it? Which is fan base, right? So now, if I were to go to tour, and this is why I have not been touring recently, is if I go to some city I've never been before, but I've already got X amount of fans there I know about, right? Because of this, because we're in touch, they've bought merch, I can count on some ticket sales over there. Instead of just trying to go out of the blue or financially gamble a whole bunch of money on advertising. And now my nut is even higher that I have to crack to get. It's a tough. So it's going to do that for me. But also just building a system that they then hand over to me at the end of the contract that I could run myself and gear more and more of my efforts towards that. You know, these are both things that are going to lead to the point to where I don't have to do an average of 20 gigs every month and teach two or three evenings a week and never able to take a vacation. And
mm-hmm. Yeah. And this is kind of related, and I hope without me spending two or three minutes explaining why it's related. Do you prefer playing, in an ideal world, would you do more acoustic type shows or would you do more electric type shows?
In an ideal world, I would do more electric with a band.
Okay. Yeah, I understand that.
Yeah, that's just bringing all of my skills to bear on an acoustic. My voice has gotten so strong and I'm easily 50-50 guitar and vocals at this point, but my lead guitar was always my strong suit, and it's something that, you know, it's a shame when you don't get to use it.
Yeah, yeah.
It's never used better when there's a band just pounding down the screen. You know, it's, to me, it's not even about look at me, look at me. It's, I feel like an artist that's painting this picture that's got this humongous screen in front of them, right? And given no parameters or little few parameters, right? And I oftentimes am surprised myself by what comes out. And for me, those are the funnest musical moments. The most magical. And those happen frequently on stage with a band for me. But acoustic, you know, kind of, but not the same way.
Yeah, I get it. I totally get it as someone who's spent so much time performing in band configurations and having done some acoustic stuff as well. But yeah, as an artist, for you, the night is your canvas when you've got your electric guitar on.
Yeah, there's just so many more options available to you. You know, that being said, the acoustic stuff, far easier.
Yeah, yeah.
It's far easier. It's easier to get paid and get paid well. It's easier to work all the time. Just everything about it is easier.
Mm-hmm.
And because I am a strong vocalist, I'm still bringing a large gun to bear musically. You know what's funny? And I've never figured this out. Traditionally, I'll get more people complimenting my guitar playing at an acoustic gig and more people complimenting my voice at a band gig. Up until about the last year or so, I mean, it seems to have evened out, but it used to crack me up. I'm like, everybody's talking. Maybe because I noodle around in between songs on the acoustic a little bit. I don't know. I can't figure it out.
You know what? The first thing that jumped into my mind was that depending on the band and the venue, what they hear as in any given moment as the featured part, like the featured solo of a song, may vary. And maybe over time, the bands have gotten better, not necessarily like better personnel, or that may be part of it, but it gels better from every moment up to including the sound at specific venues, and people can appreciate it better. Because you know how it is, if you hear a great guitarist who's kind of got an okay sound going on that particular night because of the ambience of the room, versus another night where it's just like super clear and the rest of the musicians are laying back just right, then it makes a big difference.
Yeah.
Back to that marketing, the music marketing manifesto, I just wanted to comment an observation. You can tell me if this is true for people that don't know anything about John Oszajca and his program. I remember when we were doing some musician marketing events in the Bay Area, and the first time we had you come speak, you brought that program out and talked about what it has done for you and kind of gave some examples. And you really, as I recall, you were really enjoying and putting to work the resources that program gave to you. That's correct, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. The principles that I learned, you can use in many different ways, not just online. Yeah.
Yep. That's what I recall. So, okay, I can see why you're excited too about checking out their more kind of new full service thing.
Well, the other thing that helped me see this, because I'm super leery about these places, there's somebody always looking to fleece the poor musician with stars in their eyes, you know, just pay this fee and I'll show you how to make it. And they can't do anything for you. I have a bit of a background in marketing. So when he was talking about the nuts and bolts of his program, I knew that what he was saying was true. It was sound.
That's good.
So when he gets to the part that I didn't know about yet, I trusted him and I listened. But it made sense. But yeah, I'm expecting good things. We'll see what happens.
I know that you almost wanted to wait to have our conversation today because you're so close to implementing some of the stuff. We'll work something out where I can follow up and share it with people that are listening or subscribing to the regular emails that go out about the community. I know that you and I have also talked a little bit about this, and you maybe have even heard a little bit about it on the podcast and probably elsewhere. But as we're recording this, the forthcoming episode is dedicated to the topic of house concerts. And the about one or two episodes back, I can't remember, I think it's two, I interviewed a woman named Amy Killingsworth, who's a founder and producer of Gary and Amy's House Concerts in San Antonio. And a couple of the guys and one of the gals, at least one of the gals that's been on the podcast thus far, all these people I'm about to mention or that I'm referring to piqued my interest or renewed my interest in house concerts. So now I'm getting kind of excited learning more about it and sharing things that I'm learning about it. But the reason I asked you about the whole, like, do you prefer doing, you know, in an ideal world, is it electric or acoustic for you? But I know that what I have gathered with touring, house concerts can either be your tour if you're okay with the scaled back type of configuration or acoustic gigs, but they can also be fantastic fill-in shows, if you will. And anyway, I just wanted to encourage you, if by chance you're among those who are still learning about the whole scene and like how does one get more sort of embedded in that community, I hope you'll check out the episode that's coming up. And I'm trying to put a lot of resources in the show notes and on the website for people to learn more too. So.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely something, since I do so much of it, I could always do both when I go out on the road.
Yeah.
Which I'm expecting to do when the album comes out, and especially with the help of this marketing campaign. You know, it bums me out because, like, I had to turn down two different chances to go to Europe because some of them were guaranteed and some of them were relying on door sales. And I was just like, I just don't have the mechanism in place. And doing this for a living, if it didn't pay off financially, I would have came home and been homeless.
Yeah.
And it's always, you're trading today for tomorrow and tomorrow for today. You know, I traded tomorrow for today because there was little doubt in my mind it would have moved my career forward. But there was a chance in the short run I would have paid a serious price for it.
Yeah. You're bringing this up because delaying it to get involved in the help that the Music Marketing Manifesto people are going to be providing will make it more doable in the future?
I'm hoping. I mean, the idea is, we will know where all these people that sign up are based out of, you know, and if I see, hey, there's 50 people in Tucson, it's like I can shoot out, set something up in Tucson and have direct contact with these 50 people that if 35 of them can make it that night and half of them bring a friend, you've got a 50 some odd person crowd on top of whatever else. Hit 10, 15 bucks a ticket or something like that. You've got a little bit of security there and it makes a big difference. But one has to travel. It's at the point I've been very lucky and I've done very good. But even me, as successful as I've been, living in one of the most expensive places to live.
Yes.
If I'm going to move forward, I'm going to have to travel. I'm going to have to take some risks, but I'm trying to hedge my bets as much as I can because my safety net's gone, you know.
Well, I think that's smart.
Or there's not much of a safety net left, I should say it that way.
Yeah. And I know you are in a high cost of living area.
Yeah.
Can you tell me a little bit about who's going to be on the new album, switching gears here?
I've got my producer who was on my last album and very close friends with my last producer who, I don't know if you remember, sadly he passed away just a few months after we released the album, which was quite a blow. But basically I got the whole crew minus Randy Ray Mitchell. He played slide on a track called Satan and St. Paul on my last album. And he has his own studio and he's a producer, you know, just a few miles away from where Al was. And he's got Johnny Kruperek, who was the same bass player on my last album as well. I just saw him, went and saw Walter Trout a few months ago, and there he was. He's touring around with Walter Trout, and he's great. These guys have all played with everybody. I mean, huge names, too. Huge names. And the drummer was a guy I hadn't met before named Tom Filman, they're just fantastic. I don't know that we're going to have anybody else. I think it's going to be those four people will be the ones doing, you know, including me, will be the ones doing the contributions. I'm going down there to lay the final tracks on the 12th. We recorded everything except the lead guitar tracks in 2 days, which I've never done. I've never done that before in my life. 11 song album.
That's cool. Are there four of you or five of you?
Well, there was me, a bass player, a drummer, and the producer, who was doing some supporting tracks, like maybe some rhythm guitar, and he may do some other instruments, strings. But that's so including the producer, there was four of us is all involved at this point, unless we add somebody. I don't know. And there's always that possibility, but as far as I know, it's just going to be us.
And what's your anticipated release date? You can just guess. I won't hold you to it.
So I anticipate to have finished product in my hand as early as the end of this month, early next month. I may choose to hold on and not release it at that time. You got to look at a lot of factors. Also, I'll be handling the release differently because I'm using a different method of marketing the album. So I might get it in hand and start selling and have a couple local album release parties, but put it in the hands of the online marketing folks and then choose after a few months to have an official release. And because it's expensive and it doesn't actually make you money to hire a publicist, but you get the radio play, you get the great magazine. Well, at least I always have. I guess if you put out a piece of crap or a mediocre album, you might not get good magazine reviews, but I'm smart enough to know that I won't make an album without a really good producer. So he'll make sure that I don't put out crap. But
that's good.
It doesn't make you money, but there are tools that you can use to make you money. So I probably will divert if there's a reasonable amount of success in the coming months. I probably will divert a few thousand back into going ahead and hiring a publicist again.
Cool.
Yeah. So I'll kind of cover all bases.
I'm excited for you. Any surprises, anything different going on as far as your approach or the sound or anything like that that we can anticipate?
Yeah. Well, Al and I actually talked about this at the wrap of the last album. I went a little more country.
Okay.
It's not a country album, but as I said, I've always had elements of blues, rock, and country in my stuff. This album's just got a little more country elements than previous
ones. Is it maybe a little more hardcore Americana then?
Maybe. Again, I'm going to have to see when we get to the mixing how it actually boils down, and really how I approach the lead guitar tracks is going to even make a difference on it. But I would say at the core, a number of these songs would actually fit very well in a modern country station. And, you know, and some, a couple of them would fit in a modern, not a traditional blues station. And still, again, a couple of them would probably fit in maybe a classic rock station or something like that. There's different elements of different stuff, but I intentionally did that. It's always been, when I write songs, for whatever reason, they often tend to come out country. And then I tweak them and make them sound more blues rock, you know, but they'll have that little country edge. I don't know why. When I got to the songwriting stage in my career, that's what was coming out. And so I just kind of let it go this time and, you know, wrote a lot of different songs about different things, but they just feel a little more country. And that's, we're deciding to just go with that. There's this new movement of the second wave of outlaw country, you know, which the first one was, of course, Johnny Cash and those guys, which I still love that music. And I'm just excited to hear that coming out of Nashville, that there's a new kind of mix of what they're calling outlaw country. I'm all for it. If I get labeled outlaw country, fine. I'm cool with that.
Yeah. Well, I know it's going to be great. I look forward to hearing it. I hope that I can get some previews as soon as the first tracks come out. I'll definitely stay in touch or beg you for some if I have to.
Oh, you'll definitely get some. Yeah.
And hey, man, thanks again for spending time with me today. For those of you that are listening, all of the stuff that we talked about and probably a little more, including where to find Mike online, is going to be in the show notes. Mike, thanks again. I really appreciate you.
Thanks for having me. Always a pleasure.
Absolutely. We'll talk to you soon.
It's another dreary day as I get out of bed. Wish this cloud didn't have to follow me around. Your words hit so hard, made a wound that will not heal. Wish I had a time machine, but I don't. But if I could, I'd go back, do it all again, this time get it right, so I wouldn't have to see you suffer and know it's all my fault. Wish I had a time machine, but I don't, but I don't. I would gladly give my life to heal yours, but I can't, 'cause it just don't work like that. Long twisted trail through the rights and through the wrongs, all along the way my love was ever strong for you. Guess that's not enough, but if I could, I'd go back, do it all again, this time get it right, so I wouldn't have to see you suffer. No, it's all my fault. Wish I had a time machine, but I don't, but I do. So sad, feel so bad. As time passes by, a little more of my soul dies. You don't seem to heal, so I can either give my life for a time machine, but I can't, it just doesn't work like that. Another dreary day as I get out of bed, wish this cloud didn't have to follow me around. Words hit so hard, made a wound that will not heal. Wish I had a time machine, but I don't. But if I could, I'd go back, do it all again, this time get it right, so I wouldn't have to see you suffer. And know it's all my fault. Wish I had a time machine, but I don't, but I don't. So here we are. What now? Just gotta keep keeping on. What choice do I have? Give my life for a time machine, but I can't, 'cause it just doesn't work like that.
Hey, thanks again for listening. The Unstarving Musicians podcast is edited for sound and content quality by Juan Perez. The intro-outro track is Alarm Clocks, written and performed by Redwood. That's me on drums. Visit unstarvingmusician.com/podcast to find more episodes. And please consider supporting the podcast by subscribing on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your favorites. This episode was powered by The Unstarving Musician's Guide to Getting Paid Gigs, How to Get Booked and Paid What You're Worth Over and Over Again, available in paperback and for Kindle on Amazon. The ebook is now available on Apple Books, Kobo.com, and just about anywhere else that you might find ebooks. It's also available as a standalone podcast called The Unstarving Musician's Guide Podcast. You can learn more about the book and companion podcast at unstarvingmusician.com/book. I'd love it if you picked up a copy, and I'd love it even more if you left a review on Amazon. With much gratitude, peace, love, and more cowbell.